if you are saved. Bring it on. Bring it on. Amen. You can type that in the comments section. If you're watching online, just let people know that you're listening. It's encouraging to the rest of the family if they see your name pop up there. And you say, Pastor, why do you do that every Sunday? Are you ready for the Word? It's because there needs to be an openness to receive, not my thoughts. I don't want you to receive my thoughts. I want you to receive from this book. Come on, somebody. From the Word of God. And it also that my job is to preach God's Word, right? And I'm ready to share a message today. We're in a series out of the book of James, and I want to talk to you today about how that faith without works is dead, all right? And in fact, this message is really kind of at the heart of this epistle, this letter. James is a very practical writer. A lot of the things are very practical, easily applicable to our lives. But this section here is a little bit more theological, and that's a good thing. Now, back when I was just a boy, that was quite a while ago, pastor's son in kids' church, we used to sing a little song. And I wonder how many of you know this song today, if you're saved and you know it. How many of you know that? If you're saved and you know it, say amen. If you're saved and you know it, say amen. Here's the part I want you to catch. If you're saved and you know it, then your life will surely show it. That's the key part right there. If you're saved, your life will show it, right? Now, that's a simple little song, very powerful, a song about being saved, born again, following Jesus, being a Christian. And it tells me that if I'm saved, my life will show it. And it goes on to say my life will surely show it. And that little song is kind of a summary, okay, of this entire passage that we're going to look at this morning. And so basically what James tells us in this passage, he says, if you're saved, if you're born again, if you have real faith, your life will surely show it by the works that you do. Okay, so this passage is about true faith, real faith, genuine faith. And I not only want to have that true faith myself because I want to go to heaven, but I want to teach what true faith is, and we're going to do that today. So I want to preface this message with something that Jesus said, all right? There are a lot of people who are going to be surprised when the day of judgment comes. Here is why. They think that they have true faith, but they don't. And there's not many scriptures that trouble me, but this one is a very powerful scripture that Jesus said. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 21. It's going to be on the screen here. You can follow in the notes. This is what Jesus said. He said, not everyone who says, or everybody say says, underline that word if you got notes. Everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, and this is a part that troubles people, and it's a kind of a scary part. He says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. These are people Jesus is talking about who say that they're Christians. They even do Christian-type things like casting out demons and prophesying. And yet Jesus says scary words to them when he says, depart from me, I never knew you. And so we need to know what true faith is, right? Obviously, from this passage, we can garner that when you know Jesus and he knows you, right, you've got true faith. But the question becomes, how does this all work, right? Am I saved because in my mind I decided to believe in Jesus? Am I saved because I claim to be a Christian? Am I saved because I said a prayer one time? What is it that constitutes real faith? And so let's dissect this passage today and answer that question today. And so I have two questions for your consideration this morning. And the first question is a little deep, maybe a little logical. It requires some explanation. And so, but it's the only way I could think to get this out there, just to ask this. So the first question, number one, is James in conflict with the Apostle Paul? And I want to say absolutely not, okay? And I'm going to explain all that in just a moment. How many of you know the Bible doesn't have any contradictions in it, right? It's true from the beginning until the end. It doesn't contradict itself. So we got to know what Paul taught so we can understand the answer to this question, all right? So Paul taught us in the book of Romans and Galatians that we are justified by faith alone. In other words, we are made right before God, not because of what we do, not because of the works, we are made right before through faith. Paul says, I am justified. In other words, I am made as if I have never sinned by faith alone. So when we trust in Christ, according to Paul, when we put our faith in Him, we're justified before God. But James has the courage to look at this from a little bit of a different view. Now, how many of you know that truth is often like a coin, right? There's two sides to it, right? You can look at something one way, hey, that's a heads, flip it over, that's the tails. And that's kind of what happens between Paul and James. And so, as we jump into this passage, I want you to note what James has to say. James 2 and verse 14, we hope you're following along in your Bible today, taking some notes. This is what the New King James Version says. What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says, hey, there's that word again. Someone says he has faith but does not have works. Can faith save him? Let me read it out of the New International Version. I kind of like it in the NIV. It just speaks to me a little more. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Now, those are two rhetorical questions, and James is looking for an answer, and the answer he's looking for is no, such faith cannot save them. And so, as James introduces this subject, he's wanting to share with us the relationship that faith has with works, okay? He's not contradicting Paul, but obviously James is starting out this discussion with the thought that claiming to have faith, saying that you have faith, if you don't have any works, it's not very profitable to you. In fact, it's dead to you. It's useless. It cannot save. And so now James, of course, is going to give some arguments to back this up. We're going to look at all that. In verse number 20, James says these words. He says, faith without works is dead in the New King James Version. Another version says, faith without deeds is useless. And so James is concluding his argument here. We're going to jump down to the conclusion of the argument, all right? James 2 and verse 24, this is what James says. He says, you see then that a man, now notice what it says, is justified by works and not by faith only. So we need to understand and be certain about what that word justified means, all right? My dad taught me when I was a little boy that justified means to be made just as if I'd never sinned. That's what it means, to be justified. And James says a man or a woman is justified by works and not by faith only. And that's where it gets very interesting as you look at what Paul said over in Romans 3 and verse number 28. He said, for we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. So if we put these two side by side, if I could get the next slide up there. I just added another slide there. Okay, there it is. Okay, if we put these two side by side, it looks like there's a contradiction. So who is right? Actually, both are right. There's no contradiction between what Paul says and what James says. Paul says that we're saved by genuine faith in Jesus, all right? The moment you trust in Christ to take away your sin and forgive you and become a new creature, how many of you know you're saved? Come on. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's a beautiful thing. But James looks at the other side of the coin, and he says that the sign of genuine faith is that it will result in real, measurable change in our life. And if we can't see how our faith has changed us, there's a good chance that we've never had genuine faith to believe it to begin with. Hundreds of years ago, someone much smarter than I, actually Philip Melanchthon, was studying this, wrestling with it, and he came to this conclusion. This is a great quote. He said, "We're saved by faith alone, but not by a faith that remains alone." That's exactly right, right? Now, we understand and we know that no amount of works can save a person, right? You can't earn your way into heaven. If you gave all your money away, did good deeds every moment from now until you died, that would not get you into heaven. But we also know this, that faith that doesn't reveal itself in works and doesn't show itself in works and glorifies God and has compassion on others, that type of faith is dead and worthless and useless. We're saved by faith alone, but we don't have a saving faith if there's no evidence of change in our lives. Now, sometimes it helps to see this sort of thing that James is talking about, and I've got to quote a comedian. I don't think I've ever quoted this guy. In fact, I don't even know who he was. I found this quote on the internet. His name is Louis C.K. I don't recommend him. The only thing I know about him is that you know, he made this quote, all right? And this is what he said. And this is what James was talking about, all right? He said this. He said, "I have a lot of beliefs, and I live by none of them." That's just the way I am. They're just my beliefs. I just like believing them. I like that part. They're my little believies. That's what he said. They make me feel good about who I am. But if they get in the way of a thing I want, this comedian says, I sure just do what I want to do. That's a very sad statement, right? I have a lot of beliefs, but I live by none of them. And that's exactly the kind of faith that James opposes. It's exactly the kind of faith that's dead and useless. And if that's us, James is saying, we're fooling ourselves. We don't really have any faith at all. So if we examine our lives and all we have are little quote-unquote believies, and it's not affecting our lives, then maybe we need to discover what real faith is. And so that's the next question that I have for you. Number two, what is true faith? And I want to give you some things to think about this morning. How many are still with me? We made it through that theological part. All right. All right, here. Well, I want to give you something to think about. True faith is more than what we say. It's more than what we say. James 2, 15 and 16, James gives us an example. He says, if a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, hey, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? How many of you know that doesn't help that person at all, right? If you're hungry and you say, oh, just be filled and warm and happy, that doesn't help them at all. And I think that James is really offering a real scenario that could happen and probably has happened many times. This wasn't hypothetical. It's not hard for us to understand that back in those days there were rich and poor people within the church, and it's not hard to imagine that at one point somebody didn't have enough food or clothing, you know, to make it through. Now, it's not really talking about, you know, having to, you know, stop watching cable TV or, you know, not eat out as much. This is talking about the basic necessities of life, right? And like having clothes to wear, having enough food to eat. And so when this scenario plays out, as it does even today, how do we react? And James pictures somebody, all right? He pictures somebody saying the right things, right? Wishing that the person had what they need without doing the right things, without helping to alleviate the situation. And let's not be too hard on this person's words, okay? I mean, they say the exact right thing, right? Be warmed and filled. They pronounce a blessing on their poor Christian brother or sister. It's not their words that are wrong. It's that the words are a cover for neglect and inaction. And And so let's put this into today's scenario. Let's just suppose that somebody's had a really bad run of difficulties in their life, and they came into church this morning and they say, "Man, I wrecked my car. I found out the insurance company's not going to pay for it. And you guys know I lost my job, and things are going bad for me, and I can't get a loan, and I'm about to be evicted, and things are terrible for me." And we say to them, "Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry." And how many know that those are okay words? We should feel bad for that person, right? But eventually someone's going to say something like this: "Well, I'm $200 sorry." Turn to the brother. "How sorry are you?" Right? And so we start gathering money to give to that person. And so what James is telling us, he's telling us this, that if our faith is all about just saying the right thing and not doing something, then our faith is useless. Now, we can say the right thing, but unless there's evidence that what we say changes how we act, we're deceiving ourselves. Come on. We can come to church every week and say the right things to each other, but how many of you know that's not enough? True faith is more than just saying the right things. The ones who Jesus spoke about, they were saying to him, "Lord, Lord." They were prophesying, but they weren't right. And there's a lot of Christians like this in the world today. And they may have said a prayer at one time. Somebody told them, "Well, you're a Christian, you're saved." But if you examine their life, like the little song says, their life should what? Their life should surely show it, right? But you examine their life, and what they say is, "Oh, I'm a Christian. Yeah, I believe Jesus died for me." And they seem to say all the right things. But if you dig a little bit deeper, you discover that there's no work at all in their life to evidence that. You ask them this question: "Well, do you ever worship?" "No, I never do that." "Do you ever turn to the Word of God for guidance and direction?" "No." "Do you ever pray?" "No." "Do you ever follow God's commands?" "No." "Has anything in your life ever changed since you became a believer?" "No. I still get drunk every weekend, sleep with whoever I want, take the name of the Lord in vain, cuss like a sailor. I don't give my tithe. I watch any movie I want. I don't control my tongue. I cheat. I lie. I'm not a good person in that regard. But man, I love Jesus. I'm the same as I've always been." You know what James is saying? James is saying, will such a faith as that, is that faith able to save? No, it's not. Just like the blessing that the person gave the person, "Oh, be blessed and warmed and filled." Is that saving that person? No. Even so, a faith that only speaks the thing and there's no works that accompany it, come on, somebody, that kind of faith is worthless and useless. And James says that faith is dead. Am I preaching the Bible this morning or not? Come on. Number two, the second thing I want to tell you is that true faith is more than what we believe. There are a lot of people who get real faith mixed up for what I want to call intellectual assent. Now, James is a humorous guy. I've noticed that about his writing. He's literally in this passage poking fun at people who think that if I think the right thoughts about God, if my theology and my beliefs about God are right, then I also am right. And you can ask people sometimes, "Do you believe in?" "Oh, yes, I do." "Do you believe in Jesus?" "Yes, I do." But the truth is, they're not trusting Jesus to do anything for them. He doesn't sit on the throne of their life. This is what we call intellectual assent. James 2, verse 19 and 20. That's what James says. He says, "You believe that there's one God. You do well. Even the demons believe, and they tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead?" Now, sometimes the more traditional churches, liturgical churches, they recite theological creeds. We don't do much of that. I think we've done it before, but I'm not criticizing them at all. There's nothing wrong with that. But there's an ancient creed called the Nicene Creed, and it goes like this. It says, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, and on it goes. It talks about the Holy Spirit, a whole bunch of things. And it's theologically absolutely correct. And don't misunderstand me. How many know it's important what we believe as far as the truth is concerned, right? But according to James, believing the right things isn't enough, because this is what he says. He said, look, even the demons believe in one God. In other words, he says, demons that if you were to quiz them and talk to them, they're monotheists. They probably understand about the Trinity. They know the truth about Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, ascension, and coming return. And yet he says, look at the demons. When they look at God and understand that he's one, guess what they do? They tremble. They shudder. That word means uncontainable, uncontrollable, violent, shaking from extreme fear. You say, well, Pastor Bob, why are they so afraid? It's because they know that right theology isn't enough. Amen. You can have all the theology in the world, but it's not enough to save you. Thinking the right, correct thoughts about God is not enough. Amen. Faith is more than a correct theology. You've got to have the works to back that up as well. Amen. In fact, you may be in danger of fooling yourself into thinking you're okay. And there are a lot of people who think they're okay because they intellectually assent to a God and intellectually maybe even assent to the gospel. But the evidence of faith is not there. And so we have to come down to this final thought today, and that James teaches us. How do you tell if you're a believer? You can tell if you have real faith by if it's changed your life. Thank you so much. How do I know my faith is real? You might ask. Answer this question: is your life changed, right? And after what James has said, after the warnings of Jesus, you may be wondering how to know if you have real faith. And the answer is found is, do your works show it? James 2 and verse 17 and 18, this is what he says. Thus also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. And this is what James does. He challenges them like this. He says, show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Now, if we were to put you on trial today, we're not going to do that, but if you were going to be put on trial today, and you would have to be convicted of being a Christian, a true believer in Jesus Christ, the question is there enough evidence to convict you or not, right? Well, you say, well, how would you go about doing that? Well, obviously, it wouldn't be about what you say, because Jesus said there are many who say, Lord, Lord, and they don't enter in. So it's not about what a person says. You can claim to be a Christian, am I right, and not really be a Christian. Well, it's about what I believe theologically. Are you sure? Because even the demons have correct theology. If you want to have the evidence to convict somebody of being a Christian, you should be able to look at their life and see that their life is filled with works. Now, understand this. Works don't save us. Come on. Tell somebody works can't save you. You cannot get to heaven by works. Absolutely not. There's a lot of good people in the world who do a lot of good things, and we honor them. We're thankful. We're grateful for all the good works that non-believers do, right? But let me tell you something. Works do show that you have real faith. Are you following with me? Every time you're kind because of Jesus in you, it shows you have real faith. Every time you forgive someone because of the Jesus on the inside, it shows you have real faith. Every time you pray, every time you give, every time you have compassion on somebody, every time you die to what your flesh wants in order to live to what the Spirit wants, come on, it's a work that shows that you have real faith. Are you following with me today? Come on. You say, well, Pastor, isn't it about reading the Bible and praying, you know, going to church? Hey, all of those things are good things. But let me tell you something. It's also about being able to pay your bills on time. Hello, somebody. Being a good neighbor. Being a good employee who works 8 hours for 8 hours pay, right, with a good spirit and a good attitude. Come on. It's about being a faithful and an honest husband or a faithful and honest wife. And father and mother, come, all of those things are all those areas and those roles in our lives are areas where the works that we have demonstrate that there's a true person by the name of Jesus who lives down on the inside of us. Come on, if you believe that Jesus lives on the inside of you, just give the Lord a big hand of praise today. Come on, and if you believe that that faith that's down on the inside of you will demonstrate itself and manifest itself everywhere you go, every moment of every day, by good works, give them another hand of praise today. Because that means you've got real faith. True faith is not just what you say, not just what you believe, but James looks at the other side of the coin. He says, it's what you do that matters. Amen. Amen. And then he gives us some examples. The first is Abraham. Let me touch on that quickly today. Now, we know something a lot about Abraham. Let me read what he says. James chapter 2, verse 21. He says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? How many remember that story in the Old Testament, right? He had a son that he had waited for so long, desired to have for so long. God challenged him about what he was supposed to do. He was to go and literally offer his son as a sacrifice upon the altar. Now we know a lot about Abraham, right? What did Abraham do? God called him out of Ur of Chaldees, right? And he said, I want you to go to another land that I'm showing you, and I'm going to make you a great nation. He didn't have any children at that time, and so Abraham obeyed the Lord, and he went. And then one day he's out looking at the stars of the sky. You remember that? And he looks up there and he sees all the multitude of stars. And God speaks to him and says, I'm going to make your descendants like the stars of the sky or like the sand of the sea. They're going to be innumerable. And at that point, he doesn't have any children. And finally, after years, right? After years of waiting, finally, when Sarah's, 99, and Abraham's 100. She gives birth to little Isaac, right? And he's so happy because now he has an heir. And then just a few years later, God says, listen, I want you to demonstrate, show that you have real faith by offering your son to me on the altar. This was a time in Abraham's life when God wanted to test the quality of his faith. You say, well, how did he respond? Did he argue with God? No, he did not. Did he run away like Jonah? No. Did he pretend not to hear? No, none of these. Genesis 22 and verse number 3 says this, Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey. That's what he did. Got up early in the morning, saddled his donkey, gathered the stuff. Got the knife, got the wood for the fire, and got Isaac together, and they started up that hill towards Mount Moriah. You know what he was doing? He was showing that he had real faith. You say, well, what was going on in his mind? I'll tell you what was happening in his mind. in his mind. The book of Romans tells us that he was reasoning in his mind. He was saying to himself, listen, the God that I serve is so marvelous, so great, so true. I have such faith in him that I know that if I plunge that knife down into my son, that God is able to raise him from the dead. And the scripture says that figuratively speaking, he actually did receive him back from the dead, right? And so Abraham gets there, and I'm sure, I mean, you got to think about Isaac here, man. Isaac's like, where's the sacrifice, Dad? Don't worry about that, son. But somehow he got him up there, got him bound up, put him, and he's just ready to plunge the knife in. I can't make it sound like a ram. I don't know what they sound like, all right? He heard a ram in the thicket, and God had provided. And what James goes on to tell us, he says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? And he goes on to say, do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? Listen, when he offered up that son, his faith was made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. And then he goes on to say, you see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Amen. And then he gives a second example, all right? That second example was Rahab. James 2, verse 25 and 26. It says this, likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. You say, well, what kind of a woman was Rahab? She was just a prostitute, a harlot, living in the city of Jericho, and she, like everybody else, had heard of this great movement, this great army of the God of Israel, and then she had heard of the God of Israel who parted the Red Sea, and she had faith. It was a belief that she had, but she demonstrated her faith when the spies came to the city of Jericho. She hid those spies in her house, right? And can you imagine that the people saw them go in? They told the king, and the soldiers all come over, and they're looking for the spies. You know, the easy thing has been just to say, oh, yeah, they're over here. But she did not. She took a risk. How many know faith sometimes takes a risk? Amen? Faith sometimes takes a risk. She took a risk. She had faith in God. And that faith led her to hide the spies. And it was that faith-inspired, risk-taking quality that took Rahab from being a prostitute in a pagan country to a new country, to a new land, where, check this out, she became the great grandmother of David, the greatest of the kings of Israel. You see, what God says is that we're to demonstrate our faith and we're to show it. Amen? If you're saved and you know it, your life will surely show it. Amen. Would you stand with me today? Thank you so very, very much. Amen. What a joy to be able to bring this message to you today, this holiday weekend. Amen. And just honor him and believe. You say, well, how do I apply this to my life, Pastor Bob? A couple of things that we can do. The first thing we need to do is we need to examine ourselves, right? Did you know the scripture says this? Let a man examine himself to see if he is in the faith. That's what it says. Examine yourself to see if the faith that you have is real faith. We've talked about real faith today. Maybe you're listening online today and you're realizing, man, you know, I just don't have many works in my life. I need to do more. I don't have a person that just says something. I don't want to be something that just believes some theological fact. I want to be we talked about a couple of weeks ago, a doer of the word. I want to be someone who walks it out, lives it out. I want people to look at my life and everything they see, they say, man, that guy's like Jesus, because look what he does, everything he does, the smile on his face, the joy that he has in his heart.
the peace that he demonstrates, the words that he says, the encouragement that he gives, the prayers that he prays, the way that he walks, the way that he lives, all of those things demonstrate that he's a believer. I want that. Me and us. If that's not in you today, let me pray for you in just a moment. You say, well, Pastor, I do a lot of good things. I'm a good person. Maybe there's somebody watching this today. Someone shared it out, and you're watching this today, and you're saying, well, I'm a good person. I do good works. But I don't have, you know, I'm okay. Let me tell you something. Have you ever told a lie? Almost all of us have, right? Have you ever stolen something, even a grape at the grocery store? Pencil in school? Quarter from your mom and dad's change counter? Have you ever looked at a woman with lust in your heart? If you answer those quick questions, yes, you know what that makes you? A lying thiever, a thieving adulterer at heart. The truth is, everybody needs a Savior, come on. We all need to be forgiven. We all need to put our faith in the Lord Jesus.